finally we are here and the fans are loving it. Southeast Asia, they love their motorcycles and they love their motorcycle racing even more. In Moto3, the world championship at the moment is still a close one. Jorge Martin, after his win in Aragon on 191 points, 13 clear of Marco Bezzecchi, who is on pole here today. But concerns over Jorge Martin's fitness, an unusual hand injury or disuse of the hand. He cannot have any power in it because of a massage that basically went wrong, and nerves and tendon damage. We'll have to see whether he makes it onto the grid and whether he fancies it. That's going to be the big question as we make our way onto the grid. Steve Day here, Matt Burt alongside me, and Simon Crayfar down on the grid then to bring you all three races here today. Surely, after this morning's warm-up, Matt, with that improvised glove that they'd come up with to try and help movement in his left hand, Martin will give it a shot.
You've got to bet your last dollar, hasn't you, that Jorge Martin defending that narrow 13-point advantage over this man, Marco Bezzecchi. He will have to find a way to start the 22-lap Grand Prix. There is your number 12 then, the man on pole position, the 19-year-old Italian. The last time he started from pole position, his previous only pole before yesterday here in Buran was at the Red Bull Ring in Austria. And on that day, where it all comes down to horsepower and top speed, Marco Bezzecchi prevailed. I'm just looking out of our commentary box window actually here, Steve. I can see very late on, Jorge Martin is coming to the grid, as we suspected, to take his place. 12 places behind this man, Marco Bezzecchi. So if he's looking for any good omens, last time he started on pole in Austria, he went on to take the victory in a classic Red Bull Ring encounter.
Excuse the pun, Matt, but I feel a little like his hand is forced here.
He's got no choice. Yeah, he has absolutely got no choice. Potentially, if Bezzecchi wins and you're sat in the sidelines here, you could be going to Japan 12 points adrift in the World Championship. As we look at Jaume Massieu, well, his qualifying performances of late have been absolutely impeccable. Second on the grid for the third time in the last four races. Will he finally be able to convert one of these cracking qualifying sessions into his first ever podium on that Best of Capital Dubai KTM machine? Of his last 10 races, Jaume Massieu, a very mixed bag. Six of them have been top tens, and four, he hasn't scored a single point.
Here is Kazuki Masaki, about to speak to Neil Hodgson in British television. Great performance from him yesterday, of course. Former Asia Talent Cup rider, Red Bull rookie champion of 2017. Best ever qualifying. He's on that front row. You can hear that noise now. We've got Wang Tanenon fans just below us here in the commentary box. It's a fantastic atmosphere building up here in Thailand.
I think we've basically got the entire Apiwat Wang Tanenon fan club sat right in front of us. He's not lacking support here. None of the Thai riders are, with Somkiat Chanter and Nakarinata Ratpuvapat there. Here is Chip, as he's affectionately known. Of course, a message there, a sentiment echoed by everybody in the MotoGP World Championship at Indonesia in our hearts after the awful events of the earthquake and subsequent tsunami over the last few days. There is Nakarinata Ratpuvapat then starting what could be his one and only Grand Prix appearance in Thailand from 20th on the grid. Surplus to requirements in the Honda Team Asia squad next year, and not in particularly chasing hard a ride to keep himself on the grid in 2019. So a big day for a man who's already created history as the first rider ever in lightweight world championship history to take point scoring places. Down to Simon Crayford on the grid for the first time.
Yes, guys, I'm in the fifth row with Jorge Martin. Jorge, it's been a tough season, it's been an impressive season, but for today, what's going through your mind?
Well, today will be a difficult race. I will try to finish at in front as possible. It will be really, really tough because my hand isn't really good, but anyway, we will try our best and try to finish at the top.
Best of luck.
Yeah, thanks as always to Jorge Martin. It has been a real difficult weekend. His problems caused in the most bizarre and weird circumstances. He's not had a crash that's aggravated any problem in that left arm, which he broke, of course, the radius bone a few weeks ago in Brno. He was having a routine massage here in Thailand, as riders do on a daily basis to keep themselves in top physical condition. And during that massage, he's basically trapped or pinched or disturbed the nerve, which is really hindering him opening and closing that left hand. So a bizarre injury, but one that could prove so, so costly in the final outcome of this 2018 Moto3 World Championship battle.
He's a mighty warrior, though, isn't he, Jorge Martin? He's defied odds a few times when it comes to injuries. This isn't an injury, of course. He's in no pain. He just doesn't have the feeling. But if anyone can battle their way through to a podium, it's someone like Jorge Martin. He, of course, looking to try and defend that 13-point lead. Darren Binder here. I'm not sure about the headwear, but he does start from sixth on the grid. Back down to Simon.
Yes, I'm on the front row with Kazuki Masaki. Kazuki, it's been a really impressive event for you. First pole position. What do you have planned?
Yeah, his plan is just for all of them. Then, yeah, it's the important is the beginning of the race, first three laps. So I try to follow them. Then after that, I try to keep the position. Then is maybe last five laps is here is a bit hot, so the tire will become the drop the grip. So I try to manage the tire, then last is I try to push hard.
Okay. Yeah. Good luck.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Simon. And great effort there by Kazuki Masaki. His English not the best. He's very nervous because of his English, and he's very nervous because he's on the front row of the grid for the very first time. So all credit to Kazuki Masaki for talking to us. We look back at Jorge Martin leading the World Championship at 191 points. I tell you what, if Darren Binder can't find a ride in the Moto3 World Championship next year, he could always get a job with the South African water polo team. But I'm not too sure about that headgear.
Darren, I know that you probably watch these races back. That's shocking, mate. I'm sorry. That is absolutely what on earth is that? Just have your haircut. Come on.
Well, we saw there that clear close-up shot of the improvised, that modification on that left glove of Jorge Martin. They're basically fitted, for the want of a better word, just a couple of elastic bands, really, just to try and help open and close that hand. It's going to be a long, arduous, tough, physically and mentally demanding 22 laps coming the way of Jorge Martin. But when the chips are down, when his back's against the wall, he is a fighter and a warrior.
No Aaron Canet here, of course, so there is a chance for a few to try and close up in that championship as we look here at Nicolò Buliga. Back down to Simon, though.
I'm with Nicolò Antonelli on the second row. Good luck, Nicolò. How are you feeling?
I feel good, and it will be a hard race for everyone, for everybody, but we will try to do our best, and thank you.
Thanks very much to Nico Antonelli and to Simon Crafty. I'll tell you what, from our commentary box window, Matt, if you look over at the Honda grandstand, turn 10, it is absolutely buzzing over there. There are massive Thai flags waving. It looks like some atmosphere. They're dancing away over there.
Yeah, it's a carnival atmosphere, and we haven't even had a wheel turned in anger yet here this morning in Buriram. Bosecki, will he be brilliant in Buriram? Here's the name of Bastianini. Well, he may well have taken pole position from Marco Bosecki, that 142.235, putting the Italian in pole position. But Bastianini, well, there was late drama in that qualifying session for the Leopard Honda man. He crashed at the final corner when well set to take pole position. He skittled that poor old Somkiat Chandra, the Thai wild card as well. But Bastianini, pass fit, a bit off the pace this morning in the warm-up, down in 24th place, but he starts from the middle of that third row in 8th place. The adrenaline will kick in and help out Bastianini.
He needs it as well. 58 points down on Jorge Martin in the World Championship. If he's got any aspirations of trying to fight for this still, as you rightly said this morning in warm-up, Matt, he's going to have to win two or three races between now and the end of the season. Fabio Di Gianantonio is still hanging on in there as well. He's ninth on the grid, and he's third in the championship, 41 points adrift. Believe it or not, Fabio Di Gianantonio is only 3 points short of his best ever tally in Moto3.
Well, he's speed up bound in Moto2 next year, and if he's to have a big say in this Moto3 World Championship, he needs to speed up, basically. Needs to find his way to the podium a little bit more often as we go back to Lorenzo Dalla Porta, very strong in this morning's warm-up session. 10th on the grid, heads to that fourth row of the grid. Just, landmark day for him, his 50th World Championship appearance. The Misano winner, of course, a career best run of races so far, or in this current run, Dalla Porta points in the last six.
There is Nico Antonelli, who was just speaking to Simon Crafar a moment ago, being kept cool by crew chief Marco Grana there. If you fancy an each-way punt on someone getting their first ever podium today, maybe Ayumi Sasaki is one that you might want to look at.
So 22 laps, a historic day for Thai motorsport, for Thailand sport in general. The Moto3 World Championship race coming your way. Marco Bezzecchi on pole position from Jaume Massia and Kazuki Masaki. Arbolino Antonelli and Darren Binder on row two. Nicolo Buliga, Enea Bastianini and Fabio Di Gianantonio on a high quality all-Italian row three. Lorenzo Dalla Porta leads Yuma Sasaki and Vicente Perez, the career best qualifying for the Spanish rookie on row four. Jorge Martin down in 13th place, his worst qualifying since the Red Bull Ring in Austria last year with Suzuki and Wong Than Anon. Row 6, Marcos Ramirez, Alberto Reynas and Philip Ertl. John McPhee heads row 7 from Nakarin Atharat Pupipat and Adam Noradin. Then we've got Jakob Kornfeil, Somkat Chantra, Adam Noradin on row 8. Andre Migno, Jeremy Alcoba and Alonso Lopez after a really tough day for the Estrella Galita Honda team yesterday. Second last and last for the Spanish-based team. Of course, this weekend without their talisman, Aaron Canet, sidelined with that arm injury he first sustained in Misano about a month ago.
Now, we know, and Simon Crafell has been mentioning all weekend, that there's been potential drama in terms of tyre selection here for Moto3. Is it going to be medium? Is it going to be soft? Simon, what do you know?
You're dead right. It's a mix. Our majority are medium. Well, everyone's on the medium front. Majority is on medium rear. But what I'll do is read through the soft rears, the guys that have gone for that, who are Marco Bezzecchi, Jaume Massia, Tony Arbolino, Darren Binder, Ayumu Sasaki, and who else there? Marcos Ramirez, Philip Ertl, Adam Noradin, Keito Toba, and Stefano Nepa. That's it on the soft rears.
So crucially, Matt, there, the thing that sticks out to me is that Bezzecchi and his championship rival, Jorge Martin, have gone for completely different rear tyre options.
Yeah, that is interesting. Four of the top six then have gone for that soft rear tyre, as we heard from Simon Crafell, for Marco Bezzecchi and Jaume Massia, the first and second in qualifying. Arbolino and Binder on that road too as well. So interesting, given the fact that these conditions are incredibly hot, unbelievably hot in this tropical part of the world. I was listening to some comments from Danilo Petrucci, the MotoGP rider for Alma Pramac Ducati yesterday. He said just to keep himself hydrated, he's sweating so much out on circuit, he's been drinking a minimum of 10 litres of water a day. So a brutal 22 laps coming the way of the riders. It's so hot. Probably the most toughest condition they've encountered so far this year. We've got another one coming up your way at the Sepang International Circuit in Malaysia. But the Moto3 field then come to the grid for a moment of history. The first ever motorcycle Grand Prix to be staged here in Thailand.
There are your four riders that are in the championship hunt with no Canet here. They're the only four realistically we believe that could win this championship. And if you were to really push us, you'd have to think it's either Bezzecchi or Martin. Martin has got to try and get some damage limitation. Valentino Rossi here will be hoping his riders can pull off a great result here today. Bezzecchi needs to try and close a 13-point gap down in the championship. There are five races remaining in 2018. Jaume Massia, one of the last riders to the grid, as he lines up on second spot. There's Jorge Martin. If anyone can pull off a heroic result, it's the number 88. Green flags wave at the back. We look to the top left of our screens for the lights to go on and off for the start of this Moto3 race. A bit of a delay, but away we go. A really good start there from Jaume Massia. It's obviously a short run to turn one in a moment, but it's going to be Bezzecchi who gets that whole shot from Massia. Good start there, and Binder's up into fourth.
Yeah, as you were in terms of the top three, Bezzecchi got the whole shot. Jorge Martin's out well wide into that tight first corner. It looks like they're all safely through. No dramas at the first corner. Is Bezzecchi exactly where he wants to be? Will he get slipstream by Jaume Massia? You're right, Steve. Binder got a dream start, up two place from sixth to fourth, although Arbolino is already fighting back up the inside at turn number three.
Kazuki Misaki goes up into second place. Jorge Martin really did get mired down after going wide. There he is. He was in a right pickle there midway through, so he's lost a couple of places, certainly. Ayumi Sasaki up ahead of him. Buliga, Dalla Porta as well. And Martin's just got to be careful here on this opening lap to try and keep himself clean. But it's Bezzecchi that leads.
Deep in the mid-pack is Jorge Martin as they sweep through turn four for the first time. Marcos Ramirez well out wide, as were the two Estrella Galicia Honda. Through turn five for the first time, it's still the bowl man. Bezzecchi making the early running from Kazuki Misaki. Brilliant start from Misaki, trying to be the first Japanese rider since Tomoyasu Kayama at the Sakura Ring in 2010 to have a Moto3 or a lightweight world championship podium.
Di Gianantonio needs a good result today, and he's in a pretty good position. He's made up three spots. He's into six, just behind Darren Binder. He's just gone up the inside of Darren Binder, in fact. There is Jorge Martin. He's just started to pick off a couple of riders, but he's got a lot of work to do here. He's gone past Jakob Kornfeld.
He had a bad second sector to Jorge Martin. He lost two places, dropped down from 14th to 16th position, did the World Championship leader. So, Bezzecchi, nobody's been able to find a way through on Bezzecchi on this opening lap, down into this tricky, tight turn number 12. It will be Bezzecchi that leads on the end of the first lap from Masaki. Arbolino piling the pressure on Jaume Massia. Arbolino came over the line in third place. Massia's not going to find a way through back at turn one, and here comes the Yuma Sasaki. That was super aggressive up the inside of somebody in turn one.
Yeah, that looked really, really close there for Ayumu Sasaki into turn one, but he's just about managed to make that stick. It was on Darren Binder. Bezzecchi it is then that leads, and in, out of the slipstream comes Kazuki Masaki, and the Japanese rider leads as they make the run down into turn three, but late on the brakes there from Bezzecchi, and Arbolino too.
Yeah, and Fabio Di Giannantonio is starting to look really menacing. He's just got the inside of Jaume Massia into fourth place. Masaki then what led a Grand Prix for the first time for all of about a tenth of a second. Bezzecchi razor sharp on the brake standing at turn number three. There's Jorge Martin. He came over the line in 18th place, so he lost five spots on that opening lap.
Bezzecchi said yesterday in the press conference, plan A, get out front, try and take off, basically, so that there's nobody in the group. It's Di Giannantonio squeezes underneath Kazuki Masaki there and moves now into third place.
First lap and a half has been brilliant by Fabio Di Giannantonio. He's picked up now six spots in that lap and a half. Next in his sights will be Masaki. Check on Jorge Martin. He's picked up one place. He's now in 17th position. Darren. Slow starts from the likes of Rodrigo and McPhee. They're only just inside that top 20. Two guys coming in this weekend that we thought would be leading protagonists. Their charge hasn't materialised at all as yet.
Bezzecchi leads then from Arbolino, who's looking really aggressive there, the number 14. Masaki and Di Giannantonio there, and here comes Darren Binder for a little sniff up the inside. That was aggressive, but he makes up two or three places there, the South African.
He's getting really aggressive. This is brilliant for Marco Bezzecchi. While there's a massive carve-up and chaos going on behind him, Bezzecchi got a bit of clear daylight now between himself and Darren Binder in second place. Darren Binder, where has he been all season on that Red Bull KTM? A season best sixth place on the grid, and here he is now taking the fight to Marco Bezzecchi. Somebody got pushed out well wide at turn number 12. Kazuki Masaki, there was almost contact there between Binder and the Japanese one. And coming through that fast turn 11 as well, Arbolino's aggression was really costly. But the Giannantonio, oh, Masaki, he had to get his elbow out there just to lean on Darren Binder. Binder was just forced out a little bit wide by Arbolino's move up the inside. There's a bit of paint swapping going on here in this lead group behind Bezzecchi.
As you would imagine, with three long straights, it's going to be carnage. Bezzecchi, though, is doing the job he needs to. He's almost half a second clear on board here with Di Giannantonio. Looking back at number five, the KTM there of Jaume Massia, but a double slipstream going on behind him as Masaki retakes that position off Massia.
Keeping company, he's not used to at the moment, isn't he, Kazuki Masaki? Di Giannantonio finds a way back up the inside of Binder at turn five. He's made a couple of nice moves there at turn number five as Fabio Di Giannantonio. Not an easy place to overtake. Very bumpy on the entry to the corner there when you're trail braking in. He's got a lot of confidence in that front end, Di Giannantonio, so far.
Just looking a bit further back, and Andrea Bastianini struggling in the early stages, maybe feeling ill effects of that crash from yesterday. He's in 15th.
But even a fully fit Bastianini, Steve, we see him off the pace so often on a full fuel tank and new tyres in these races. He's not a million miles behind. He's been kept in it by the slipstream here. Jorge Martin has been picked off by Gabriel Rodrigo, who's starting to claw his way through the pack. If Rodrigo can get on the slipstream at the back of this lead group, he's going to be coming back into contention as well.
Oh, that was almost carnage there. Di Giannantonio and Arbolino have lost huge time down into turn 12. That is what can happen there. And now Di Giannantonio's hard work. He's got to start all over again. And Rinas was quick across the line. He's up to seventh.
Look at the slipstream effect further down the field. The fastest lap of the race has actually just been set by Dennis Foggia, who's way, way down in 19th position. But a 1:42.963 from Foggia. He's the first man of the race that's dipped into those 1:42s. Confirmation on your screens there. Foggia in 19th place, but the fastest man on track.
Darren Binder in second place there, number 40 on the Red Bull KTM, has not been anywhere near a podium so far this year. He's looking for a ride next year. He's riding well, and he is not letting Bezzecchi out of his sights.
Steve, that mistake or that tangle between Arbolino and Di Giannantonio at the final corner, you were right about how costly it was going to be. Di Giannantonio was inside the top three in the braking zone for turn 12. He came over the line in 11th. Cost him seven or eight places, all that shenanigans and drama at turn 12.
KTM City at the front at the moment with these three. We're about to see the move from Darren Binder. That was aggressive, but it was well done. And that, oh, I tell you what, it was really that that basically meant that Dejan Antonio and Arbolino had nowhere else to go. That's the second time in this race already Binder's had his elbows
sponsored
out.
Sponsored by Red Bull. He's riding like a raging bull at the moment, is he, Darren Binder? There's a lot of orange and blue paint all over the side of Tony Arbolino.
And he's down, and that was a harsh move from Albert Arenas. He's wiped out Darren Binder, who's not impressed at all. A few harsh moves. It was bound to happen at some point in this race.
It's been coming. The field is so condensed because of the slipstream. There's some real tight, hard braking zone into tight hairpins. That was not a case of if but when.
I tell you, he's looking good, Matt. Ayumi Sasaki's up to third now. He is charging. He is so hungry for his first ever podium here. And he's now got up into third, and he's in the slipstream there of Lorenzo Dalla Porta. Jakub Kornfeil's got the fastest lap of the race so far. He's in ninth.
What a confidence boost this would be as well for Ayumi Sasaki, breaking his podium duck going in to Italian Grand Prix in Japan in 2 weeks' time. There's one of the most controversial moments of the race so far, the collision between Albert Arenas and Darren Binder, and one of the Estrella Galicia Hondas has also perished in this race, although Alonso Lopez was a long, long way back, and Jeremy Alcoba also struggling outside the top 20.
We've got a change at the front. Lorenzo Dalla Porta leads, as he did in Misano, of course, race winner back then. Bezzecchi then has lost his lead now.
Bastian, and he was in way, way too hot at turn number three. With that slipstream, he'd have been entering the braking zone about 5, 6, 7 k's quicker. He just couldn't pull it off on the brakes. Look at the Gian Antonio trying to break the slipstream down into turn number four on completely the wrong side of the circuit there, the Gian Antonio. Dalla Porta then, with Bezzecchi for company. Sasaki looking over for a way up the inside of Marco Bezzecchi at turn number five. That's all going to be pretty tight, pretty tasty as well. Sasaki couldn't pick up a way through on Arbolino, who stands firm in third place.
Yeah, that was the fault of Albert Arenas, that crash. But Darren Binder, to be honest with you, he had a few cheeky bites at one or two riders already in this one. I don't know.
Oh, blimey, dear me.
They were nearly followed in there. Alonso Lopez goes down as well. Albert Arenas has got his arms up. He thinks it's Darren Binder's fault, so...
Well, no surprise when it's a racing incident, the pair of them having wildly and contrasting different opinions. Back at the front then, lap five, deep into this fifth lap as they sweep through this brilliant fast right-hander, turn number 11, then it'll be hard on the brakes. This is where there's been a lot of chaos. Sasaki moves to the inside to try and pick up Marco Bezzecchi. It's brilliantly done. Jaume Massia, he had a little big wobble on that front end there, but he managed to bring it up. Oh, who's that down? Was that Antonelli?
Yeah, it is. Nico Antonelli, he's got his arms up in the air as well, saying not guilty, but they're all going down. We knew it was going to be a tricky corner. He shakes his head. Is he hurt? His airbag has gone off. Nico Antonelli down and out of this race. Onto the back straight we go. Dalla Porta leads, but Sasaki now is into his slipstream. He's known as the crazy boy. Ayumu Sasaki, a former Asia Talent Cup and Red Bull rookie champion. We've not seen him this good since he joined the Grand Prix paddock, but Bezzecchi fights back and goes through to take the lead, and Arbolino's got an inside line as well.
There's been some crazy boys further down the field, that's for sure, when you look at Albert Arenas and Darren Binder. So Bezzecchi using that supreme top speed of that KTM. Sasaki trying to get in the draft with Massia for company as well. Let's have a Jorge Martin check. He came over the line last time out, back in the points, going places in 15th. I thought Sasaki, that would have been brave in the extreme to have had a lunge up the inside.
Oh, it's Suzuki as well. His teammates involved.
Blue on blue. That's not going to go down very well at all in 658 Squadra Corsa. Not very well at all.
Let's see what happened. Paolo Simoncelli might be livid here. Suzuki takes the inside line. They collide. I don't think that's anyone's fault, majorly. That's just a racing incident.
Yeah, that's basically, unfortunately, the two of them fighting for the same piece of tarmac. You may well argue that Suzuki, being aware of where Antonelli was on the outside, the onus is on him to try and make the move safely. But what's not for any debate whatsoever is the two men, the two 658 Squadra Corsa men, are out of this race. So down to turn number 12 for the sixth time, Tony Arbolino running a real tight inside line. He's going to pick up Lorenzo Dalla Porta. Dalla Porta just had no option there. He could not turn in. Has that compromised Arbolino's drive on the exit of that turn number 12? Doesn't look like it's cost him too much. He'll have the inside line on Dalla Porta as Bezzecchi leads from Ayumu Sasaki.
Disaster for Nekarina Tirupuva, Pat, here. His home Grand Prix, and it's not ended the way he wanted it to go. He goes down at turn 12. You know, when we came here to Thailand, having watched World Superbike here, you just knew turn 12 was going to cause some problems for one or two riders, and so far it certainly has in this race.
And in these hot conditions, there's a fairly rough and coarse piece of tarmac in the middle of that turn 12, just about where you pick up the throttle, so it's not an easy corner to negotiate at all, and it's caught out quite a few riders already in this race. So
this is sensational.
There's Jorge Martin He is now still in that 15th position, although John McPhee's picked him up and dropped him back to 16th place. So outside the points again right now is Martin.
They're going to have a look at that incident between Binder and Arenas and see whether there's any retrospective punishment going, as Martin there aggressively goes up the inside of Marcos Ramirez. Every single point that Martin can pick up today is precious in terms of the World Championship. Remember that, even if he's not fighting for a podium.
Shout out to one of the local wildcards here, Somkiat Chantra. He's got Philip Hurtle and Andrea Migno behind him. Two Grand Prix winners in this Moto3 World Championship. So a great debut on front of his home crowd for Chantra.
Dennis Fodge has done a brilliant job. He's come through from where on the grid? He was way back in 25th. He's now part of this leading group, the number 10. You can see that green number 10 there, just in sixth place.
Well, he was kicking himself for that penalty he got for irresponsible riding in Aragon. Dropped him to a pit lane start. He felt like he had podium pace. Three abreast, he's not going to work into turn number 12. And the big loser there was Jakob Kornfeld. He just got squeezed well to the outside. His teammate, Marco Bezzecchi, leads over the line to start lap number 8. The advantage over Della Porta, just over 600ths of a second.
One of the big problems Ayumu Sasaki's had since he's joined the Grand Prix paddock is getting a front end stable. He's not been able to make overtakes. No such drama today. They think they found a setup since Austria. It's certainly paying off. He's in third. It's Dalla Porter here, though, just ahead of him.
Of course, true what they say about confidence and results breeding confidence. Vicente Perez, back-to-back point scoring place in the last two races. He's part of this league group. The career best, 12th place on the grid for Perez on that Reale Aventure Academy KTM. Outstanding ride by the number 77. He's just there, right in the middle of your picture, trying to pick up some slipstream from Gabriel Rodrigo on that run down to the fast turn 4.
Jorge Martin makes up another place as Kornfeld runs wide. John McPhee's up there with him as well, but every single point handy here for the number 88.
Kornfeld had a nightmare at turn 12, Steve, on that last lap. He came into that turn 12. He was in that sort of top 5-6 group. Got pushed out wide. He's lost a whole bunch of places, have been dropped back down to where Jorge Martin's currently circulating.
But he was wide at turn one as well,
yeah,
it was just a disaster
corners,
really for him. And a group like this, where you've got Marcos Ramirez at the back of it, who's 18th. And they're all in the same camera shot.
Well, this is more kudos to Somkiat Chantra. He's 17th, but he's only 2.3 seconds off of your race leader, Marco Bezzecchi. What great World Championship, top-level, elite-level motorcycle experience this is for the Thai wildcard.
Still quite a few riders in this group that pack a punch. There's a few riders that will be contesting for next year's Moto3 World Championship, that's for sure. Fabio De Giannantonio, though, beautifully blocked past into the final corner and will lead across the line. There's 14 laps remaining. He leads from Bezzecchi, Dalla Porta and Sasaki.
There's going to be some monumental fireworks on those last couple of laps. If this group is like this, going into the final two laps at turn 12, you can't make a strong case for some of these riders finishing the Grand Prix. It's Fabio De Giannantonio, really under pressure from Marco Bezzecchi. Simon?
Guys, I'm here with Nicolò Antonelli. Nicolò, can you tell us what happened from your point of view?
What happened? I think my teammate crashed me, I think, because he go full in me, in the exit. And I don't know why he do like this, but it's not the first time, and I'm really angry for this.
Thanks for your time.
Team mate in inverted commas, I believe. Now, wow. Tony Arbolino, Steve, is part of this league group. There are track limit penalties coming. Oh, no, sorry. Enea Bastianini and Tony Arbolino have got to drop positions because they've overtaken under yellow flags. It's so fast, frenetic and intense, the battle at the front. There's been numerous crashes this race so far, and Bastianini and Arbolino have somehow got to find a way of dropping positions in this league group for overtaking under yellow flags. How do you do that?
It's very hard to say, but you know, they are the rules. You cannot overtake
absolutely
on yellow flags, and there have been a few of them so far in this race. Going back to the Antonelli situation, Paolo Simoncelli will be fuming. He will be fuming.
Out of absolutely nowhere as well, Steve, Fabio De Giannantonio was bolted. Biggest lead we've seen from anybody in the race so far. He came through sector 3. He was up by almost half a second. I don't think he's going to be able to break away with the slipstream, as Jorge Martin safely negotiates his way up the inside of Kazuki Masaki, who's just struggling to go with the pace now. The man who started on the front row of the grid for the first time. Masaki's been dropped now, pretty much outside the point scoring place, and he's getting that front end hopping around all over the place, going into the first corners when he was out well wide there. Masaki, is he already struggling with that front tire in this punishing hot conditions?
Di Gianantonio's weaving, trying to prevent people from getting in, but it's not working. Bezzecchi here is into the slipstream, and here comes Dalla Porta, and he had a half a second lead and is almost gone down into turn three. Martin is doing a really good job there in 12th. He's just steadily picking them off one by one.
Just keeping his powder dry, keeping himself out of trouble. Top right again here, as we mentioned before, Vicente Perez. He is now tucked in behind Jaume Massieu, battling for sixth place. Brilliant stuff by Perez, the 20-year-old who came in halfway through the season to replace Livio Loi. Foggia again set another fastest lap, 142.963. Four abreast into turn number five. Well, it works this time around. I'm not too sure it'll work very often after that one. Foggia, he's looking really, really strong. Dennis the Menace, isn't it? That's how we like to call him. Well, he's looking very menacing at the moment at this stage of the race, just before the halfway stage.
Dalla Porta leads then from Bezzecchi. Then it's Ayumi Sasaki and Fabio Di Gianantonio. Dennis Foggia tracking them, number 10. Then it's Gabriel Rodrigo, who we've not mentioned much so far, but he's been inside that top eight for most of this race so far.
Yeah, he's done an excellent job as well. Rodrigo ghosting through from 24th place, his worst qualifying yesterday in 2.5 years since Austin back in 2016. Sasaki does like to run that real tight line. Bezzecchi got in hot. Bezzecchi got in way, way too hot at turn number 12. And the man who's second in the World Championship, well, he was leading, wasn't he? And he's wide and sweeping on through. Come Dalla Porta, Sasaki, Di Gianantonio, and losing the momentum. He lost all the drive coming out of turn 12. And it's dropped Bezzecchi now behind Dennis Foggia into sixth place. Costly mistake.
Onto this 1 kilometre long straight. We're on board here with Marco Bezzecchi in fifth place. There's Dennis Foggia that he's trying to pass now. Up ahead there, look at the slipstream effect down the back straight. As Foggia looks for that inside line on Ayumu Sasaki. Di Gianantonio here is just ahead of him in fourth. It's still Dalla Porta that leads.
He's got plenty of time to correct that big mistake, as Jakob Kornfar's almost out on the grass on the exit of turn number three. He's going to be careful because he'll be getting busted for exceeding the track limit. Martin then has finally made his move up inside the top 10. He's up into ninth place and he's starting to come into contention for that podium. Jorge Martin, when he clocked over the line to start lap number 11, he was only a second off your race leader, Lorenzo Dalla Porta, and Dennis Foggia, who has come from deep, way, way outside of the top 20, and Foggia now leads the Grand Prix.
Incredible stuff here in Thailand. What a race. There's two big packs forming now. John McPhee has tagged onto the back of this one in 13th, but there's a bit of a gap forming then back to Enea Bastianini.
Don't want to put the mockers on Foggia, but twice this season he has led in both Austin and Brno, and he's vanished without a trace. He's encountered some major, major rear grip issues in the second half of the race because he's been attacking so hard in the opening part of the Grand Prix. So we'll be hoping, and Foggia will be hoping, that he can hang on in there a bit longer this time around. He's given the real pressure on the brakes in the turn number 12, but he stands firm. Bezzecchi's fought his way back up into third. And there is Vicente Perez, brilliant by the number 77, now right looking on the door of the top three and four.
Yeah, this is fantastic stuff then from the Reale Avintia Academy rider Vicente Perez. They put him on the bike for a reason, and he is certainly showing them what he's made of here. Of course, this is a circuit that is new to pretty much the entire grid, with the exception of the odd rider who's raced here in the Asia Talent Cup. Jaume Massieu has all of a sudden appeared in this group once more as well, as up the inside there goes Ayumu Sasaki. Not a lot of room at turn three. Brilliantly done there by the Petrona sprinter rider.
He didn't do any favours to Perez though, did he, as Arbolino runs really, really wide. Perez got forced well wide onto the dirty part of the track at turn number three, costing three or four places. Foggia, he got absolutely blitzed on that first 1 kilometre straight. He was leading going into the first corner, and he got swallowed on that Sky VR 46 KTM. He's been pushed back down now. He's trying to hang on to a place in the top six.
Just as Enea Bastianini always does, he's just started to warm up. He's at the lead, at front of that second pack, but he's closing in on this group. Will it be too little too late once more from the beast?
Tony Arbolino pretty close to Jorge Martin's rear tyre there as well on the exit of turn number three. So ten and a half laps to go, and Bezzecchi's forced his way back to the front of the pack.
Into sector four we go. Tip it around turn number 11, and then onto this short run down to the tricky and hectic turn 12. up the inside there. Dalla Porta goes on Sasaki. Fabio Gianantonio trying to move as well. And Jaume Massia sits up Ayumu Sasaki into turn 12 as well and now moves into third place.
And we've called him Magic Martin so many times. We've said Miracle Martin so many times. He's on course here to pull off another miracle here. Jorge Martin over the line last time around. He was in seventh position. Vicente Perez just got up the inside of him though, did he briefly, but Martin now is starting to look really, really threatening. He's going to get slipstream behind his fellow Spanish rider down this 1 kilometre start straight.
To this back straight, Dalla Porta seems to have sector one absolutely nailed. Really strong through there. There is Vicente Perez with Gabriel Rodrigo in there and Jorge Martin and Jakob Kornfahl. At the front though, it's Dalla Porta, Bezzecchi, Foggia.
Not one to be pushed around, Perez. He's giving as good as he gets in that lead group. A couple of times he's been pushed out wide, but he's been aggressive and attacking himself. Bezzecchi will have the inside line for this blind entry turn number four. Difficult now to make overtakes. I'll tell you what, Jakob Kornfahl is going to have to be very, very careful. That's the third or fourth time now I've seen the number 84, Marco Bezzecchi's teammate, running well, well wide. He may well be getting an exceeding track limit penalty very, very soon, Kornfahl, because he's struggling to keep it on the black stuff at the moment.
Couple of riders running wide. Vicente Perez has done it a couple of times now as well, so he'll want to be careful because he's on for a career best result. Bezzecchi it is that still has the advantage then. Three Italians at the front of this one, from then Sasaki and Massia.
We do know that race direction under a new directive this year will give warnings before riders are penalised for exceeding the track limit. So unless we've not been fed that information in the commentary box, there's been nothing that's been flashed up yet on Jakob Kornfahl's dashboard as Dalla Porta hits the front again at turn number 12. Nicely done. No way that Bezzecchi could retaliate from that one. Someone who is starting to look pretty ominous as well as Steve makes him a couple laps to go is Gabriel Rodrigo. He has now got himself up into seventh place. Top six next in the eye line for the Argentinian areas on the number 19 RBA racing machine.
The two groups are one again as well, because Anaya Bastianini, along with some Kiat Chantra, are back up with this group.
Got himself in the point scoring places. Who could have predicted this? Some Kiat Chantra halfway through or over the halfway stage of the Thai Grand Prix with the likes of John McPhee, Philip Hertl, Marcos Ramirez and Nicolo Buliger behind him, and Anaya Bastianini as well. Some high-calibre, high-quality riders that Chantra's dicing it out with.
Yeah, he'll be a full-time rider in this paddock next year, of course, in Moto2. The two rookies, though, are at the front of this one now with nine laps remaining. Foggia and Sasaki there, one and two, but not for long as the slipstream effect comes through. And then Ayumu Sasaki's got the inside line into turn number four. And the crazy boy leads. Crazy boy leads from Dennis the Menace.
Yeah, a few good headlines to have there as Chantra.
Oh, someone's down. It's Sasaki.
Sasaki's down.
Sasaki's gone down.
It is. Ayumu Sasaki, you can see him out of that commentary position. Well, the crazy boy will be crazy now and not in a good way. Ayumu Sasaki, he had just hit the front of this Grand Prix.
It was looking like being the special day for Ayumu Sasaki. It did look particularly close between him and Foggia as they rounded...
It's tricky at turn five, Steve. It gets bumpy on the entrance here. Now, did he just get a little bit of a helping hand? No.
No. Maybe he was out slightly wide.
Maybe
but
out a little bit wide. And it is bumpy. We've seen a lot of riders getting a lot of chatter, front-end vibration through there. But Sasaki, oh, it's been a horrible lap for Japanese talent because straight after Sasaki's gone down, Kazuki Masaki, who was on the front row of the grid for the first time, well, he's bitten the dust as well. Horror show for a couple of the top Japanese talents in the field.
So into turn one we go. A little bit of a gap then forming as a result of that crash a moment ago. Foggia it is though that still has the advantage. There's Dalla Porta, Rodrigo and Perez with Martin just behind them.
Just can't quite get within a second. As look at that, Foggia. Brilliant slipstream down the long 1 kilometre straight. He just moved effortlessly through on Bezzecchi and Gianantonio. It's that all-Italian top three right now. Well, an all-Italian top four with Lorenzo Dalla Porta keeping Vicente Perez at bay. Sasaki has been able to rejoin the race. Sasaki will live to fight another day. What a chance gone. Thrown into the gravel for his first ever victory. Gianantonio there. That was a beautiful move. He set that up brilliantly at turn four, but he's had his pocket picked at turn five by Dennis Foggia. Martin engaged in a real intense battle now with John McPhee. Here is Masaki, who's been able to remount his RBA race machine. Ayumu Sasaki has tried desperately. I can see him out of our commentary box window to get going again, but it's not happened.
Martin contact here, is it? Yeah, a little bit of a nudge. Race direction are going to have a look at that, Matt. They will have a look. It may well just be a racing incident. Masaki doesn't think so, though. There was contact between Martin and Masaki there. Here is Martin, though. He's in eighth place as it stands. We are riding with the World Championship leader. He's been giving a track limits warning as well.
So race direction, talk about eagle-eyed on Jorge Martin. That's an aggressive move by the Gian Antonio up the inside of Dennis Foggia at the final corner, but all's fair in love and war. The Gian Antonio then hits the front. He leads over the line at the end of lap number 15. Martin is in eighth place on the number 88 under pressure from Arbolino, and Arbolino's picked him off at the first corner. Nicely done by Arbolino, so Martin loses that eighth place.
On board here now with Fabio De Gian Antonio as he leads from, look at the slipstream.
Well, there's two things that have got an issue here for Fabio De Gian Antonio, Steve. One is his weight and his size. He's one of the lankiest riders in the field, which means he's always going to suffer in the straights. And of course, the Honda just hasn't got the poke, hasn't got the power. As Vicente Perez just gives him a little tap on the backside there with his front tyre. That got a bit tight through turn number three, but poor old De Gian Antonio with his natural physical size and that Honda just missing that crucial top speed, that horsepower. He's a real, leaves himself wide open to the slipstream on that first straight.
Martin just got bumped wide a bit into turn number three. He's dropped down a couple of places as Foggia looks to go up the inside into turn five and makes it stick just about. Vicente Perez is out a bit wide. Yeah. He's lost a few places. McPhee's looking a bit sharp here as well. Number 17, slowly but surely, is pushing his way through. Of course, we know what he can be like in amongst big groups.
That was a case of Perez pushed, and not for the first time. It was Jakob Korn who put him out on the dirty stuff. He couldn't open the gas as much as he wanted to, Vicente Perez, and that let three or four riders just breeze up the inside of him. It'll be so demoralising when you're Fabio De Antonio to just see four or five bikes just sweep on past you effortlessly. The FIM stewards, as you'd expect, they've already had a look at that Albert Arenas, Darren Binder incident early on. It's under investigation, the Martin Masaki incident.
Martin up the inside now with Masaki's teammate, Gabriel Rodrigo, two in one.
He's winning no friends at RBA Racing right now, is he, Jorge Martin?
So, six laps remain in this brilliant Moto3 race, and Marco Bezzecchi leads from Dalla Porta, Foggia, and De Gian Antonio.
Six laps to go here in Thailand, and the top 16 riders have split by less than 2 seconds. 1.8 seconds covering that top 16, down to Nicolò Buliger, just at the top of your picture, who's battling with Philipp Hertl. This is anybody's.
There'll be some riders that have fallen in this race that will be absolutely gutted a bit later on. Darren Binder on for a great result. Albert Arenas, Ayumu Sasaki. So many riders that could have been kissing silverware a bit later on, but it's not going to happen. Simon.
I'm on the pit wall with Dennis Foggia's team manager, Pablo Nieto. He's led twice already. In really extra good form today. Did you see that coming?
Difficult to say, because it's true that this morning in the warm-up, we make a really, really good warm-up. But it's difficult to say, because we was starting on the 20 feet on the grid. So he feels really, really good now, and I think he have to try to make the best that he can. But difficult race, big group, that one that is now first can be the 10, and that one that now is in the 10 can win the race. So difficult to say.
Thanks, Pablo.
Thank you.
Thanks to Pablo Nieto. Yeah, we're talking there about Dennis Foggia, number 10, who is looking very aggressive at the front of this one. Tony Arbolino lost huge time. He went well, well wide, and he's now at the back of this front pack. Bezzecchi it is that leads. He got some good drive onto the start-finish straight.
And who was out wide again on the wrong side of the curb out of turn 12? It was Jakob Kornfeld. Got to be very, very careful, because the only rider so far that's had a track limits warning, or the one that we've seen on our sponsors here in the commentary box, is your World Championship leader, number 88, Jorge Martin, has been embroiled in a fair amount of drama in this race so far after the contact with Masaki. He's inside that top six, though, at the moment, is Martin, although Rodrigo's going to slipstream him as he down onto turn number three. No, he can't get through. De Gian Antonio, in turn, though, finds a way through on Foggia.
There is Jorge Martin. He's currently in seventh place. Marcos Ramirez is now part of this leading eight group, number 42. He's just up behind Gabriel Rodrigo there, and he's made up a handful of places in the last couple of laps.
Foggia thought about a pretty brave move and bold move up the inside of De Gian Antonio at turn four. Didn't quite, was close enough, and Kornfeld in turn says thank you very much. He lunges up the inside off Foggia at the very next turn, turn number five. As we look at the freight train, in this Moto3, a classic first ever Grand Prix here in Thailand. It's been everything we imagined and more so far, with Bezzecchi still holding a slender advantage over Lorenzo Dalla Portiere. Vicente Perez, I'm not surprised to see he's got a track limits warning. That's just fired up in our commentary box here, because the number 77 on more than one occasion, quite clearly, as it's been in this league group, has been on the wrong side of that blue and white curve. So Perez has got to be very, very careful, because he may well be compromising his first top 10 here.
Wide again there is Jakob Kornfeil. He's just about within track limits this time around, though. Across the line we go. Fabio Giannantonio leads from Bezzecchi.
The Giannantonio was so determined to break the slipstream there, we lost him out of our picture. He went so far to the right-hand side of the circuit to try and make sure that Bezzecchi couldn't get him on the run to the first corner. We lost visual contact of our race leader.
Ramirez has just gone wide into turn one.
Finally, Kornfeil, Steve. We saw this coming a long, long way ago. He's had a track limits warning. So many times he's had track limits warning. He's got to be very, very careful here, because Kornfeil, this could be costing him a penalty. As again, Foggia used the slipstream, the superior power of the KTM to get himself into the lead, through on the Hondas of the Giannantonio and Dalla Porta.
Dalla Porta trying to break through once more. Riders taking to separate sides of the track to try and break slipstream effect, which is crucial here. Dalla Porta leads into turn four from Foggia. But here comes the Giannantonio. He's got the inside line into turn number five, and through he goes.
The Thai fans have been treated to an unbelievable show from their man Somkiat Chantra. He's in 12th position in this lead group. He's only 1.8 seconds behind your race leader, Chantra. Well set, still well on course for a top 10. Could get even better. He's not out of contention for the top six.
There's Jorge Martin getting really close there and almost tagging the back wheel of Andrea Bastianini. The last thing Jorge Martin needs to do is to come out here in this race.
The track limit warnings are coming thick and fast now. Tony Arbolino, the latest man to potentially incur the wrath of race direction. Arbolino has already incurred the wrath of race direction in this race for overtaking illegally under a yellow flag.
Martin getting so close there into turn 12 to Bastianini, who has a little look around at him. But now as we go across the line, there are three laps remaining. Martin is in seventh place. Alberto Puig taking interest here as well. Lorenzo Dalla Porta it is that has the lead as we go onto the back straight. Time and time again, these same three Italians at the front of this one look the most menacing.
It's Martin who's riding like a beast versus the beast right now. He's got Andrea Bastianini just ahead of him, Honda versus Honda. And Martin runs that tight inside line. Gotta say, he got in hot. There was the door left open by Bastianini. Martin was too tempted, he couldn't pass up the invitation, but getting in there, he just ran in a fraction hot. Bastianini on the cutback was able to sweep back straight through.
The drag down to turn number four there as we were on board with Marco Bezzecchi. He's up into second place.
It's just amazing, Steve, to think after all this racing, they've been out there now for well over half an hour of non-stop action. The top 17 are covered by less than 3 seconds down to Andrea Migno. There is Chantra on the number 35 machine. What a Grand Prix debut for him. Stunning stuff. He's in 12th place.
Oh! Fabio Di Giannantonio sits Bezzecchi up. I mean, look how much time he loses as a result of that. His teammate goes through. Gabriel Rodrigo goes through. There's an inside line there from Andrea Bastianini. Every mistake you really pay for here.
Exactly. I mean, just look at the momentum that Bezzecchi lost, Steve, in those second and third sectors because of that little tap from Di Giannantonio. He's got to do all the hard work all over again now, Bezzecchi. Straight away, he finds a way back through on Gabriel Rodrigo. So Bezzecchi slots himself back into fifth place as we head on to the penultimate lap here in Thailand. Who's going to tie up the first ever Grand Prix victory here in Buriram? Who knows? It's anybody's guess. Anybody really from this league group of about seven or eight. It's been breathtaking stuff in Buriram.
Bezzecchi's at the back of that group trying to get what is effectively a quadruple slipstream. He's going to make up one place on his teammate Kornfeil. Could he make up two or three? Foggia again, slipstream into turn three. Late on the brakes there from Fabio Di Giannantonio. Block pass, but he runs wide and through goes Bezzecchi from sixth to first.
Cool, Di Giannantonio, he's got unbelievable trust in that front end to break as late as he did. What a horror show it's been for Nakuin after that Pudapat. Unfortunately, after the early crash, he's tumbled again. So it's a double crash in his home Grand Prix for Atherat Puvapat. Back at the front then, it's Marco Bezzecchi that leads the way from Dalla Porta. The lead group sweep into turn number five, and there again to Gian Antonio. He's been lethal at turn number five. He's made so many moves. Confirmation of the double tumble for Nacarin Atherat Puvapat. Look at the name of Bastianini as well. He's come from nowhere, long, long way back. And he's got up the inside of Gian Antonio again through turn number seven. Brilliantly done by the beast.
Quickly reminding you, there's only one rider in this entire leading group that have actually got soft tyres on, and that is your race leader, Marco Bezzecchi.
Well, it just shows how much finesse and how smooth he is with that right hand, because to still have a lot of life, a lot of grip in that soft rear tyre, it's been an outstanding job here by Bezzecchi. We look out of our commentary box window as the lead group of, what, a dozen riders then come into the final corner for the penultimate time of asking, and it will be Marco Bezzecchi then that has the advantage over the line to start this crucial last lap. There's his main championship rival, Jorge Martin. If this was the last lap, the gap between Bezzecchi and Martin would be 3 points, and Bezzecchi would be a new world championship leader. There's still a lot to be decided, though, in this last, what, minute and 40-odd seconds.
Ah, oh, so quick into turn one was Lorenzo Dalla Porta, and he'll surely use...
Oh, McPhee.
Oh, he's
John
done it again.
McPhee again.
He was on for a solid top 10, and this has happened a bit too often recently for McPhee, but this is the big leading group on the final lap. Dalla Porta then trying to find his way through, and again late on the brakes. Is Gian Antonio close enough? Not quite. And now Bastianini, once again, he leaves it late, but he's up into fourth place. He's putting himself into contention here in the latter stages.
He really is. It's been a stunning charge through the pack from Bastianini. He's got three Italians in front of him. Been a great day so far for Italy. They're looking out the top five right now. Jakob Kornfeld's going to have something to say about that as Bezzecchi goes from the lead in a blink of an eye. He's back in third place. Dalla Porta to Gian Antonio sweep through.
Oh, brilliant racing here. And Jakob Kornfeld now is challenging Marco Bezzecchi as well for that final podium spot.
Well, surely Kornfeld's not going to do anything and attack Bezzecchi. He won't want to be doing anything that's going to threaten the championship charge of his teammate. The Gian Antonio has taken the lead. This is going to be super tight, super aggressive as we come into the final sector now. Fabio, the Gian Antonio, has picked up the baton. Has he timed it perfectly? So, so hard to overtake in this third sector. Fabio, the Gian Antonio, then now will sweep through turns number 10 and then the right-hander through turn number 11. It's been a stunning third sector by Fabio, the Gian Antonio. Can anybody get close to him in the breakings over turn number 12? The Gian Antonio from Dalla Porta and Bezzecchi.
It doesn't look like it. He's got it all sewn up, I think. He's got a block. Oh, Bezzecchi's gone down. The checkered flag is out. It's carnage. The Gian Antonio wins across the line, and Martin can't believe his luck. Dalla Porta second, Foggia third. They're livid over in the Prustel Radox team. Fabio and Gian Antonio wins it, and Bastianini has gone down along with Marco Bezzecchi.
That could be good night. That could be curtains for the Moto3 World Championship, and curtains in the most cruelest of fashions. Jorge Martin, with all the chaos and carnage at the final corner, will go to the Twin Rimategi in Japan in 2 weeks' time with a healthy 26-point cushion over Marco Bezzecchi. It's been a nightmare at turn 12 for an Air Bastianini. He was denied pole position yesterday against Bezzecchi with a tumble at the final corner. A tumble at the final corner, fighting for the last place on the podium. Now, this is going to be nasty here. Bezzecchi's got to keep his cool. You can entirely understand his frustration. I was actually with the marshals, but Bastianini, what was he thinking? It was the last corner, but he wipes out Marco Bezzecchi, and that will be, when we look back in Valencia, one of the pivotal moments in that world championship. Martin Ford, 26 points down the gap in the championship. Is that it all over?
Oh, do you know what happened there?
Bastianini had to grab more front brake because he was worried about tagging Dalla Porta.
Did he touch Dalla Porta, though?
No.
No.
No, you know what he's done?
He's avoided
contact. He's grabbed a handful of front brake because he's thinking, well, what's the lesser of two evils, wiping out my teammate or somebody else? I mean, unfortunately, I mean, how unlucky. I make this now the fourth time this year that Marco Bezzecchi's gone down either on the penultimate lap or the last lap. This time around, it was not a self-inflicted wound, but the wounds will be deep.
Top 10 finish for Somkia Chantra on his debut and in on home soil.
In all the chaos as well, Steve, the last three sectors, Fabio De Gian Antonio could not ride those better again if he had another million laps around this place.
No, brilliant riding. And guess what? He's also thrown himself in the championship again. He's only 29 points down now on his teammate Jorge Martin. That, by the way, is curtains for Bastianini's championship. Definitely. There's only three in it now, and it's Martin's. Fourth place for Martin with Bezzecchi out of the race. He could not have wished for a better day.
Well, you could tell you could tell the way he popped a wheelie as soon as he came over the line, because he had full visual. He was locked on Marco Bezzecchi. He saw the drama unfold right in front of him.
Another great ride from Lorenzo Dalla Porta. He was never outside of that top three or four for the entire race. He really is turning into quite a handful in this Moto3 World Championship. And Dennis Foggia, from where he was on the grid, he's on the podium. It's his first ever podium. The junior world champion of 2017 comes through from almost at the back of the field. Some brilliant riding by the three Italians here in Parc Fermé, but what a dramatic race that was. A corker. What fantastic opening Grand Prix here in Thailand.
Perfect way to kick off a new era in Thai motorsport. We thought it was going to be dramatic. We thought it was going to be tense. It didn't let us down. And we always, right from the get-go here, the minute that you came to this Buriram circuit and saw that final corner, you just thought straight away, Moto3, last lap. There's the potential there for some serious fireworks. Boy, did it explode, though. Poor old Marco Bezzecchi. My heart sinks for him. Jorge Martin, top my cap to that guy, because the way that he digs deep and finds top results when the odds are stacked against him, that was a monumental result in the World Championship. It wasn't a podium. Really, really gutted for this man. You can understand why Marco Bezzecchi, nothing. There are no words right now that will console that young man, because he will be absolutely dejected. His morale on the floor. And look at this. It's the contrasting fortunes of Grand Prix motorcycle racing. Pure and utter abject dejection for Marco Bezzecchi.
He's had some bad luck over the years as Gian Antonio, but he executed that race to perfection. And then, as you rightly point out, Matt, the final couple of sectors, he got it absolutely done, because he just made sure that no one was close enough to slipstream him. And Gian Antonio, with that victory, of course, it's his second after winning over in Italy. He finally breaks that curse of all these results only happening in Italy. Here in Thailand, he wins the race and 29 points behind. He's only 3 points behind Marco Bezzecchi after that.
He's in the game. No doubt about it. Of course, when we say it's looking bad for Marco Bezzecchi, he's still firmly in the hunt for this championship, but to lose what he thought was going to be a podium place, he was looking at a minimum 16 points. I'd imagine that's friends and family tuning in back at home in Italy. They're about to get up pretty early in the night, or early in the morning, I say, in the early hours of Italy, back in Europe to watch that race, but it was well worth it. Some strong espressos, I imagine, keeping the Gelantonio family going at this time of day.
It's 4:45 in Italy at the moment. Here is Jorge Martin. Well,
getting some liquid on board pretty quickly.
He would have taken that. He would have taken that. The bionic man, I think we might have to start calling him, because time after time, he just shows us what he's made of. Some really, really nice emotions, some heartbreak elsewhere as well. The likes of Binder Sasaki's going to be gutted because he had a good chance here today. But
yeah. What a race. What a way to kick off the Grand Prix era in Thailand. The Chang International Circuit fans, well, they've already had their money's worth, and they've got another two Grand Prix and then the Mitsubishi Asia Talent Cup race to come as well on the race programme today. We'll be hearing very shortly from our top three. Here's Dennis Foggia, then his first ever podium finish in the World Championship. He's talking to Simon Parc-Fermé.
Dennis, from 25th on the grid through to the podium, third position, how does your first podium feel?
Yeah, it was incredible race. It's really difficult because the condition was really hot, but I'm really happy about the team. I like so much the bike, and thank you for the team.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
What a result, what a ride. You'll remember that one for a long time. When you come from 25th on the grid to your first podium, you've had to work incredibly hard. What a top job by Dennis Foggia. I think it's fair to say his first World Championship podium, and definitely not his last, as the dejection will all come flooding out. Marco Bezzecchi, what a nightmare. Feel really sorry for Bezzecchi. What could he do? Taken out of the final corner by this man's teammate, Ene Bastianini. Lorenzo Dalla Porta, second here in Thailand. He's with Simon.
Lorenzo, you're back on the podium. The second half of this year is really going well for you. Are you happy?
Yeah, the third time for me on the podium. I'm so happy. Today the track is so difficult with too hot as the condition, but I think I did all my best. On the lap, on the last three corners, I did some errors. This is something to think for next race, but I'm so happy for this podium. We, like Misano, we have to follow like this, in this direction, is the good way, I'm so happy, thanks to my team, my family, my friends, everybody.
Congratulations.
Maybe one word of advice, don't take on board so much fizzy drink after you've had your podium. Great to see Lorenzo Dalla Porta. He is a rough diamond who's getting well polished. Here's Anea Bastianini, who's got some explaining to do, certainly to Marco Bezzecchi, a shake of the head. But here he is, Fabio Di Gianantonio then, a historic first ever win in Thailand for the Italian. He's in Parc Ferme telling Simon Crafer all about it.
Fabio, there was a big group of riders, nobody could get away, and you won it. You have to be happy.
Wow, this race is, I think, the most difficult race that I ever done, because for the track temperature, the temperature in the air, the bike was so hot, also the tires, everything moving. And also, like you said, a lot of riders. I was really on the limit because I really want to win this race. And then at the end, I say, okay, now it's time to do a little step more. And I did it, and it was all good, so we won again. Yeah, baby. thank you to all the guys. Thank you, Rag. Ciao, ciao.
That's what you want to see. That's what you want to see. Thanks, Simon. Pure, utter, raw emotion from Fabio Di Gianantonio, and not a bad Austin Powers impression.
Yeah, absolutely. Great scenes. As ever in Moto3 racing, heartbreak for some, an absolute jubilation for others, but I tell you what it does prove, turn 12 certainly does create the fireworks we expected it to.
Gabriel Rodrigo, close again, but still not able to find himself back on the podium for the first time since Barcelona, just a second behind the Gianantonio at the checkered flag. But a bit like Dennis Foggia, he had some serious hard work to do, coming through to the top five from outside of the top 20. Good way to bounce back from the disappointment of his Aragon DNF. And we should mention as well, of course, in all the late drama, an unbelievable top six finish for Vicente Perez.
Yeah, yeah.
His first top six finish in his first Grand Prix campaign. This is going to be, the headlines are all going to be created. Anea Bastianini skittling out a man who at that stage of the race, Marco Bezzecchi, was going to be leading the world championship.
Do you know, to make matters worse, Jakob Kornfeil had to take avoiding action when he was in fourth place. And he ended up crossing the line in 10th.
Martin, Steve, he knew how massive that was straight away. Bastianini here, look, he thinks he's going to tag the back of his teammate Lorenzo Dalla Porta, and he just squeezes that front brake lever that ever so fraction harder. It locks the front tyre. He loses the front. It gets washed out. And poor, unfortunate Marco Bezzecchi on the outside. Leopard Honda were what? About 100 metres away from a double podium there. And it has all gone wrong in the most terrible of circumstances for Marco Bezzecchi. Martin, he popped a wheelie straight away as soon as he crossed the line. You won't see anybody celebrating a fourth place as much as that man, Jorge Martin.
Beyond the celebrations, of course, you mentioned for Perez, Bulliger finished in seventh. That's his first top 10 of the year. Number one for Fabio Di Gianantonio as he kisses the camera lens. Chancher, of course, that top 10. Kaito Toba picked up some decent points as well.
Some quality rides throughout the field. Adam Noradin was back in the points as well in 15th place. What a ride as well, though, by Somkiat Trantra.
Golf buggies across the circuit to the podium here so that it faces the massive grandstand.
Yeah, quite an unusual sight, isn't it, to see the podium finishers going onto the infield to take the applause, the rapturous applause after a classic Moto3 battle here in Buriram. The fans would have appreciated that. Some of them seeing Grand Prix motorcycle racing live for the very first time. Well, if that was the starter before the main course is to come, we are in for a memorable first Grand Prix here at the Chang International Circuit as Fabio Di Gianantonio comes to the podium. When all said and done, what a day for Dal Conca Grazzini Honda. Damage limitation brilliantly done by Jorge Martin, fourth place, and increases his world championship. And the tension is only going to mount inside that Dal Conca Grazzini garage, Steve, with their two men now locked firmly in the championship battle. Just 29 points splitting the Dal Conca Grazzini Honda men.
Yeah, it looks like a hard task for anyone to beat Martin now, particularly if they can sort out that hand injury.
Dennis Foggia, 25th on the grid, comes through to take his first ever world championship podium. A standing ride by him, Lorenzo Dalla Porta comes into second position. He started to become a regular visitor to our podium ceremony, isn't he, Lorenzo Dalla Porta? But here's your race winner. Fantastic, Fabio. stunning last lap, executed those last three sectors to absolute perfection. As we await the dignitaries present here in Buriram to hand over the first ever silverware to a Grand Prix podium in this part of the world. The 50th largest nation in the world is Thailand, and they are motorsport mad over here. Team Trover then goes over to Del Conca Grassini Honda. A third place for Dennis Foggia, the 17-year-old from Roma, in his 17th Grand Prix start. Foggia then in third position. Runner-up trophy will go to Leopard Honda's Lorenzo Dalla Porta, the 21-year-old from Prato in Italy. His 50th Grand Prix start, and he marks it with his third podium finish. And our first all-Italian podium since the Japanese Grand Prix last year in 2017, when we had Fanati, Antonelli and Bezzecchi. It's Fabio Di Antonio, your race winner on the Del Conca Grassini Honda, right back in championship contention. The 19-year-old from Roma in his 51st Grand Prix, his second victory, his 13th podium. It certainly wasn't an unlucky one today for Di Antonio. If you like your stats, the 23rd time in lightweight world championship history there's been an Italian lockout of the podium, as we said, the first time in almost a year. And the scenes of our first ever Thai Grand Prix podium goes to three men who treated us to a stunning spectacle. Fabio Di Antonio, 175 points he now moves on to win the world championship, only three now behind the luckless Marco Bezzecchi, who was taken out at the final corner by Anea Bastianini.
Now, just look at the size difference on the podium there.
Well, let's not forget, Steve, if it wasn't for Bastianini going a bit balmy at the final corner on Bezzecchi, we may have had an all-Italian top five.